I am so excited that we can actually have a conversation in person with two incredible, I'll call you both Calgarians, even though you live here right now, you don't live here right now, but that's okay because sport in Calgary has been a part of your life. And so we're very pleased that Abi and Akeem could join us today. Let me give you a little bit of a bio on Abi. Abi Strate is a Canadian ski jumper. She's actually born in Calgary. So one of the few athletes who was born in Calgary, began ski jumping at, get this, 6 years old, entered her first international competition when she was 10 in Utah. In her participation at the 2022 Beijing Winter Olympics, I'm sure you all watched it, she won Canada's first bronze medal in ski jumping in the mixed team event. First time that that event happened. So very exciting to watch. Abi also notably ranked 23rd in the women's normal hill individual event with a total of 161.9 points. In her free time, which I don't think she has a lot of, let me be honest, Abi enjoys spending time outside, mountain biking, beekeeping, that's an interesting one, gardening, and caring for her chickens. So let's take a look at the video screen to see a little bit more about Abi.
Good job, Abbo!
Go, Ab. Good job, Ab. Beauty. Yay!
It's a long road. I've been through it all, so. Miss when it was us in the Volvo. You taught me how to grow, how to find hope. Now you're looking down, that's all that I know. Ain't easy, who said life was easy? I've been on the road, I've been grieving. I wonder if you're proud the way you see me. But you gotta believe me when I say, had to go through hell to get to heaven. Seen some shit and learned a couple lessons. But I've been holding on to you. I've been holding on to you. And I don't always know just where I'm headed. Devil's day keep trying to block my blessings. But I've been holding on to you. I've been holding on to you.
Please welcome Abi Strate to the podium. She couldn't even watch the video. We should have Kleenex for you too. Okay, we'll have to get some. Our next guest is Akeem Haynes. Born in Jamaica, he moved together with his family to Yellowknife at the age of 7, before his family moved to Calgary when he was 10. Haynes qualified as a member of Canada's 4x100 meter relay at the 2012 Summer Olympics in London. At the 2016 Games in Rio, he competed in the 100 meter and was also part of the 4x100 meter relay team. In the 4x100 final, the team came agonizingly close to a medal. They were 0.02 seconds behind third place Team USA. However, the Americans were soon disqualified for an improper baton pass following a review, moving Canada into the bronze medal position. Let's take a look at Akeem's video.
I'm not supposed to be here.
Because you set the tone, and either it's a good tone or you'll be behind.
I had to work for everything I ever got. I had to fight for it with everything I had.
Do it.
I couldn't wait for the stars to align for good things to start happening to me. I had to put in the work and believe that it was possible. You see, the moments that make you who you are the moments that once broke you. The moments that make you a true champion, a true winner, are the moments when you seem like your back is against the wall and you keep finding one more day to keep putting your best foot forward and keep going. You don't have to have everything figured out in your life, but you gotta know what you're gonna do that next day.
And they're away on the opening leg. Powell charging through the bend. Rogers trying to stay with him, but he opens the gap. Japan looking very strong. Through the first exchange, Canada with a nice exchange as Aaron Brown goes hard down the back straight. The Americans charging hard. Jamaica looking strong through the third exchange now. Tyson Gay chasing hard through the bend. Bolt awaiting the baton. It's
Every moment doesn't always turn out like you think it should, but who you become in that moment will last a lifetime.
Please welcome Akeem Haynes. Okay, thank you guys. Okay, I have to ask Abby first, because I look over at Abby and she's got tears streaming down her face. Why is it tough to watch? Why is it so emotional?
Well, is this on? Yeah. I didn't even watch the video. I just heard the song because the song reminds me of when I made the video and all the things that happened in the video. And they're very defining moments in my sport. And I think the struggles are a lot of what, you know, pushed me to win the medal and to get where I am today. And I think that, I don't know, it makes me really emotional thinking about it.
It's understandable. And, you know, that probably won't end for a long time. So just be ready for that. And it's good. I want to ask you, it hasn't even been 2 months, almost 2 months, but you're one of the sports, the season continues. So what has it been like since that podium performance? What's your life been like?
Well, right after we won the medal, I don't remember the next week after that, just because I hopped from so many different time zones and so many different interviews all at once. And there's like a lot of attention right away. That's why we decided to come home for 2 days, and it was absolutely insane. I don't know where my mind thought I was, but yeah, looking back on it, I saw my cousins the other day and I was like, oh, have you guys seen the medal yet? And they were like, yeah, we saw you at the airport. And I was like, okay. And then we returned to Europe and we had a whole second half of our season left. So it was just right back to work, which was kind of hard because I was like wanting to celebrate, but also I had to rein it down and get ready to compete again.
Which, while I ask Akeem a question, why don't you put on your medal? You brought your medal. So Akeem,
the medal's in the yours? Jacket. It's in the jacket.
Oh, yours is in your jacket.
Oh, it's all good.
Okay. Well, after we're done, Scott's going to run and get it. Is that okay if he goes and gets it? Okay, perfect. Good. Okay, good. People want to see the medals. It's good. Akeem, do you remember? And, you know, it's funny. Jasmine Meehan, who's one of the new counselors, and she's an Olympian in wrestling. She said, I'm one of the old ones. And I'm like, she competed in Rio. My event was 20 years ago. So I'm one of the old ones. Yours wasn't that long ago. But what was life like for you after the medal and Rio, because it was, you know, it was such a change emotionally. What was it like? But also because it's such an incredible event and it's so focused on, you know, from media wise, from viewership. Oh, there you go.
Thank you.
Do you remember what it was like when you came back?
I went back to doing what I was going to do anyway. I didn't really celebrate too much. I went to go speak in different places. I spoke 15 times in 12 days. A bunch of those places were youth attention facility centers, right? So for me, sports has always been a platform. I'm not really a big celebration guy like that. You know, I probably wore this medal on my own, opened it on my own probably like 5 times, right? Because it's always been kind of like a passport, open up different doors. And when those doors are open, who you are when you're not an athlete, when nobody's watching, gets highlighted. And for me, I show this to my community because Maya Angelou has a quote that says, I come as one, but I stand with 10,000. And that always meant me, like every single person who poured into Akeem in some capacity, whether you said hello or you waved or whatever the case may be. So when I got it, I showed it because it was much bigger than myself. So I didn't go to Disneyland or nothing, so.
I didn't go to Disneyland either. Did you go, Abby?
No Disneyland.
Okay, I don't know who's gone to Disneyland.
I thought that was a thing.
Okay, apparently we need to book a trip to Disneyland, right on. Okay, while I ask you the next question, I'm gonna ask you to show your medal. Oh, you don't have to wear it if you don't want, but show
it. Sixth time he's putting it on.
We're making it, see there. And before I'm going to actually tell a little bit of, you guys might not know this either. So every summer medal actually has to be the same on the front. It actually has to have the goddess of Nike, which is the goddess of victory, on the front. And then on the back, they can do, it has to be approved by the IOC. But a winter medal can be designed front and back, whatever they want. But
so,
because
it's, so theirs is better than ours.
Mine's bigger. Just want to say that.
Oh boy. Now this is taking a turn. but yeah, it's something actually that I learned because of the tradition of the summer medal. So the front is always the same on a summer medal. So just different. Akeem, you talk about the people. So when you look at the medal, what does that medal represent, or who does that medal represent for you?
There's too many to name individually, but it's a long list. And so, you know, for me, I think about where I started. You know, I was born in Jamaica, and just to put things into perspective, the place where I grew up in 2016, there was 99 deaths in that area alone. And that wasn't the highest death rate in Jamaica, right? And so for me, it makes me think back of where I started in life to where I got to today and what more that I can do. You know, I think the one thing that being an athlete taught me was just discipline, right? I had a coach one time who said, Akeem, man, sports will teach you a lot about life. And to me, it was the opposite way. My life experiences taught me the ups and downs of sport, right? Like injuries, when people were supporting you and then you get hurt and now it's not the same, when there's all these different things. But for me, when I look at the medal, it's just like, man, if you can overcome what you came through at the beginning stages of your life and you're still here and you're in the 1% of the 1%, then it opens a floodgate to say, you know what? What was once many may deem impossible is possible. Because if you remember where you started and you judge where you are today, probably seen a mountain of progression. So that's what it means to me. It's just a strive, progression for more.
Well, and the thing is that it's never over, yeah. Right? Even if we're retired from sport, that journey continues, and it's a part of us and it's part of our journey. And that's what actually Diane Jones Konahowski taught me that. Yeah. The fact that you can't change the sporting part, but it's how you react to that. I want to come back to struggles in a bit, because I know, I mean, everybody over the last 2 years has encountered them, but you guys have encountered them as well during the sporting career. But you talk about, you know, sort of the people. Abby, when you look at your medal, who are the people that you think of on this journey? And again, the journey, you know, it hasn't been that long a journey. Well, you've been competing for a long time, but who are the people that that you look at and you look at the medal and you think this is partly for them?
Similar to what Akeem said, I think it takes so many people. The list, like, I even remember before I went to the Olympics, I had a note on my phone and I was like writing out people that I had to thank, and it just kept going. I was like, oh, but this person, one time they said this to me, and that, no, it just, there's, the list is infinite. But ultimately for me, first off is myself, because I put in a lot of work to get the medal. But then that sounds selfish, but it's true. It took a lot of work. Then my family also, for always, like, I would never be in sport if it weren't for my family and for the community that they introduced me into. I also think of coaches, teammates, everyone that ever knew me, that knew that I was a ski jumper, all those people. And then also the people that said that I couldn't do that or that I shouldn't do that. I'm like, well, I did do that. So I think about them when I see the medal as well.
Oh, there's a rebellious side. Oh, yes, we all have that one for sure. You're referencing ski jumping, which again is not the most common. And yet, you know, we have a part of all sport one day of kids being introduced to it, and kids always love it. What was it like as a little kid getting involved in a sport like that? And you said your family, you know, putting you into sport. What was that like as a young kid? I mean, at 6 years old, to get introduced to various sports?
Yeah, so I got introduced into ski jumping through a camp where I tried a lot of other things, but I ended up sticking with ski jumping. And that's one of the most common questions I get is, why did you choose ski jumping? Why did you do that? And I think about that sometimes. And I think one of my favorite things about ski jumping is the fact that it is so unique. And the fact that, especially in Canada and in Calgary, it's not a common sport. So anyone, when they would ask me what I did or what my sport was, and I was like, oh, I'm a ski jumper, they'd be like, what's that? And I'm like, let me tell you. And it was something that I could always talk about it. It wasn't like, everyone was always interested. And sometimes the questions got a little like, yeah, how do you ski jump in the summer? Oh yeah, we do ski jump in the summer. but I just think, I went into the sport because it was so unique and different, and I fell in love with it. And I fell in love with the people that I got to see when I went to the ski jumps. It became like a second home to me.
So it's, I mean, a lot of the sport organizations that Sport Calgary works with, again, has young kids being introduced, and whether they continue in that sport or find something new, you know, it's that whole environment. Akeem, you talk about where you were born, and then you came to Calgary at 10, right? Yes. So can you talk a little bit about your introduction to sport within the community? Because, you know, track and field, people don't ask, what is that? But, you know, it's sort of, how do you get introduced and then figuring out that that's the sport for you?
You know, it's funny, coming from Jamaica, that's like what you do, you know what I'm saying? So I never really had that one. But when I came to Calgary, how I got introduced to track and field, I didn't want to do track and field ever, right? I just didn't want to. Track and field is every other sports is punishment. And I just didn't understand the fun in that, right? But I remember my high school teacher, and he's a big part of this journey, Ken Rose. He said, man, if you want to get faster for football, you should run track and field. I'm not the smartest guy, but 1 + 1 = 2, right? So I'm like, okay, that makes sense. So I ran 1 year. I ran okay. I was just juggling that in football. And then I started to take it seriously once I started to, okay, let me tell the real story, right? So there is,
please.
There was this guy, and I wasn't doing track and field full time. I was juggling football as well too. And there was this guy, and I'd beat him in the 100. He'd beat me in the 2, and I'd get second. And there was an article that came out, and he said, yeah, man, Akeem is competitive in the 100, but like, he won't beat me in the 2. And when I saw that paper, I'm just like, how is this guy going to disrespect me like that? Right. So I started to train harder and harder and harder until when I saw him, you know, I beat him by 2 seconds. Right. So it was different. But then I started to understand, like, OK, I started getting letters from American colleges, and I started to say, wait a minute, what does all this mean? And Mr. Rowe said, Akeem, you can get a scholarship here. I said, what exactly does that mean? He was like, man, they'll pay for your school. I was like, for free? He was like, yeah, they'll pay for it for free. So I started to understand that this could do something different for me. And I think a lot of times we're posed with certain questions when we're introduced to something that we enjoy and we're passionate about it, even though we know it can be impactful, it's still going to be work. And it's still going to require certain things. I've never been someone who was distracted easily. I've always been focused, sometimes too focused. But that was kind of how the journey of track and field kind of started for me. Once I got to junior college, before I went to Alabama, you know, I was a dual sport athlete. So I originally signed to play football and run track at Florida State. But some things happened, and I went to junior college, and I called my coach. Had to be in like August. I'm like, coach, what's going on, man? Where's the football team? I was going to try out. He says, Akeem, Barden hasn't had a football team since 1968. I was like, man, I guess I'll just stick with track. Here we are.
Yeah, thank goodness he stuck with track. Exactly, Abby, pointing to his medal. Yeah, that's perfect. You know, you both referenced struggles, and Akeem, you talked about sort of overcoming almost where you're raised, but, you know, even fighting you're going to do track. What would you say one of the biggest struggles that you've had to encounter during your sporting career would be?
That's a great question.
Do you want Abby to touch on it while you're...
No, I got it. I'll give Abby more time to think. When I was 13, it was never the physical work for me. You know, I never was worried about physically working hard. I always pushed myself in every barrier, especially in the off season, 3 times as hard as any other person, right? Because I knew if I put the grind work in at the beginning, then it would help me in the back end. But the hardest part for me was the belief. Not that I didn't believe that I couldn't do it. I don't lack confidence in that category. But when I was 13, you know, there was a part in my life when I was homeless, you know, sitting at a bus stop with my mom living there. And one of the hardest things for me, people always ask, what's the hardest part about being homeless? Was it the actual fact of being homeless? Yeah, it sucked. You know, it was minus 25 in Calgary, just terrible. But it was the fact that I believe I had to rethink and retrain that good things could happen to me. And so the hardest part about the track and field aspect of it is, since it's such a cutthroat thing and everybody's in the 1% once you get to a level, how many losses can a person take and think that if they get back up, that the outcome will be different? And so for me, that was kind of it, right? Because there was a 5-year span where I didn't run a personal best. And then the 5-year came, and then I became number 3 in the world, 3rd fastest Canadian in the 60 meters, right? So it was the constant belief of, if I get back up, that the outcome is going to be different. I think of it like a fight, right? You got 2 boxers. I don't think the hardest part about boxing is being knocked out. I think that's the easy part. I think the hard part is getting back up and thinking to myself, wow, if I get back up, can I beat this person? When you've taken losses and you've been beaten down, and the injuries and the delays and the setbacks and the mind games, you think to yourself, is this really worth it if I get back up? Is it going to be different? And for me, it was always practicing that as I practice block starts, because you have to practice these things every single day and you got to make that choice. So that was kind of it for me, not the physical work, but the practice every single day to believe in myself that the outcome will be different. Despite, if I lost my first 4 races, could I come back and stay confident and make a team? So that was it for me.
So I just want to elaborate for a second on that. Because then what do you say to people? Because you communicate with so many people day to day and with what you're doing right now, when they just feel like they've been literally beaten down and they don't know whether to continue. I mean, that's a tough thing to deal with at 13. I can't even imagine. So what do you say to them? How do you encourage them?
You know, so I still mentor a lot of the athletes that are still competing now, and the young ones, like my little brother, has all of the talent and gifts in the world. But I ask him, I think before we do something, we should ask ourselves, what are we willing to sacrifice in order, right? I think a lot of times people tell you what it's like at the top of the mountain. And nobody ever says the mountain at the top of the mountain that it's ever not glorious. But there are moments where you're going to have to endure and endure and endure. And in the weight, dreams can be shattered. In the weight, you can get discouraged. In the weight, you can throw in a towel. So for me and everything that I do, you know it's going to be hard. You know it's going to be like that. So I always tell young athletes, I'm like, before you embark on this and you say, I want to take it seriously, ask yourself, what am I going to have to sacrifice every single day in order to get there? Because if you know what's ahead, then you can prepare for what's to come in the everyday grind of trying to get better. So that's what I would say. That's what I tell my siblings. That's what I tell people now, you know, because if you prepare for the worst may not come, but if it comes, your perspective on it, you can attack it differently. Now you're not discouraged because you expected it. So how can I get around it? Maybe I got to go through it. Maybe I got to stop and pause, or maybe I got to go get a mentor and seek ways around it. But it's different ways to get to the destination, but don't think it's going to happen overnight, because it never does.
Abi, I'm going to turn the struggle side to you. What was has been the biggest hurdle so far for you?
I'm glad he spoke first, because it made me sit here and think about everything. My original answer, I was going to talk about, I had a knee injury that was pretty tough for me to get through, not just because I hurt myself and I had to recover from that, but I had to take a step back from sport and watch everybody else continue to compete, especially my teammates. And that was really hard for me, but that also led to, it was kind of like, I kept getting beat down after that. So I injured my knee. I took a year to recover from that. When I came back and I started jumping again, I ended up stress fracturing my other leg. And then the year after that, we lost our season for the pandemic. And obviously everyone was going through things that were way, way bigger than me losing competitions. People were losing jobs and homes and family members, but just coming back and then being told, no, you can't compete now. And then again, the following winter was a struggle for me as well, because we had coaching issues and I just, every competition, I did not qualify. I did not score points. It was just like continuously getting beat down and down and down. And that whole collection of things, just like, I think it just pushed me to the edge. And it was like, I was at a point where it was like, okay, I could risk it and keep going and, you know, get hurt more. Or, I mean, I never actually thought I was going to quit. I was very adamant on keeping going, but it was definitely a push. And I think just the, all those years combined and just, yeah, it kind of, the collection of that was probably the biggest struggle, but it all started from when I injured my knee.
So you both won medals with your teammates, you know, and you talk about the tough times. How did your team help you? I mean, Abby, yours is recent, the fact with the pandemic. And so first the injury, you're watching your teammates continue to compete, and then through the pandemic. How did the team and literally the other three, you know, help you as you guys were going through this?
I think for me, I have kind of two different teams, because the team that we competed in and won the medal with the boys, we don't train together 100% of the time. So that was actually really interesting for us, me, Allie, Mackenzie, and Matthew, to get kind of thrown in, like, especially Allie, she was a lot younger, and we actually had to bond. We bonded a lot at the Olympics, and through this experience, it brought us a lot closer together. But I know two of my teammates also I grew up with, they started jumping. We actually all started jumping in Calgary, but they're always there no matter what. They've become like siblings to me, especially the girls. We live together also. So when you're spending that much time with each other, you've got to get along pretty well. And I know that any time that I'm going through a struggle in the sport, they know how it feels also. And it's really nice to always have someone to just, that understands that piece of it.
Yeah. So, you know, I'll take you back to like the day before the relay, because Aaron didn't run so well either. I missed 100 by one spot. He was behind me. Brendan Rodney didn't make it to the semifinals, and like it, we just weren't performing well in certain categories, but we got another opportunity. And I remember the day of the race, you know, I opened up Brendan's door. I was like, yo, we need this. He's like, yeah. Okay, close the door. I go over to Aaron's door. I'm like, yo, we need this. He's like, yeah. I go to Andre's door. Andre's knocked out sleeping, so didn't talk to him. But it's a trust thing, right? Especially in the relay where, you know, you have to trust that your person is going to leave on the mark, right? And if they don't leave on the mark, it doesn't just hamper them. It hampers you. It hampers the whole team. So we knew that we had an opportunity, despite that the beginning of it didn't go so well for us. And as I realized in sport, you don't always get a second chance, but we did. So the group that we had, I've been racing against those guys since I came in the sport, right? You know, it's always, you know, Calgary versus Toronto, you know, so it's different. But when you have a second chance to go with a team trying to do a common goal, it makes it a little bit easier. We all trusted each other. We all knew what we could do. So now it was just double downing on that trust and just make sure that we execute. But, you know, I don't worry about those guys in the race, because I know them. I know that they're going to show up regardless of what's going on. And I think when you know people are going to be there for you and put aside what they're going through and be there when you're trying to achieve something, it just makes it that much sweeter. So I was never worried about what we could do. You know, I'm just glad we did it.
Right time. A few more questions. Okay, 5 minutes. Okay, perfect. Who inspired you, or, and whether it's different, who continues to inspire you? Akeem, I'll start with you.
Who inspires me? You know, I was asked that the other day. I think at the beginning stages of my life, I didn't have necessarily any person to really look up to, you know, or to say, you know, I can be like this, because I didn't really know anybody in that mindset. So for me, when I came to Canada, it was the first time that I ever seen superhero movies, like Batman, Robin, Green Lantern, The Flash. And I was like, yo, these guys are cool. Is this how it is in Canada? Right. And when I was homeless, it was one of the things as an 8-year-old kid coming to a different country, I thought this is how it kind of worked. Right. So when we were homeless and I was watching the sky go down, I was thinking to myself, like, at any moment, like, Superman, a superhero, is going to come and save us. And then the sky started to get darker, and then everybody was just passing us by, nothing was happening. And I realized, like, man, no Superman is coming to save you, Akeem. And it was at that moment that I realized, sometimes you have to be your own superhero. Who do I look up to now? I mean, I get inspired from almost anything. Right. You know, the other day I saw a bird flying from the sky. I'm like, man, that's kind of cool to be that light, to just be able to sail like that. Right. And stuff like that for me. So I get inspired by people who are doing things that they are passionate about and enjoy to do, because how you do something tells me a lot about you as your character. Right. You may not be the most talented or gifted person, but you can still do something well enough. And so for me, when I see that, I'm like, oh yeah, that reminds me of, like, you know what, Akeem, look, you took a day off the other day, and whatever you were doing, it's time for you to meet that energy and meet that. So I get inspired by almost anything. I'm easy going.
That's awesome. Abby.
Akeem inspires me as of today, this moment. I'm sitting here watching him like, oh my gosh, I need to practice more. But when I was a young ski jumper, I always looked up to an older athlete that was in the sport also. Her name is Atsuko Tanaka, and she went to the Olympics in 2014, which were the first ever Olympics that women were allowed to ski jump in. And yeah, it's pretty recent. But I remember when I was younger, she was always so nice to me. When people would kind of look over me or just see me as like this little kid, she always made me feel like I was her friend and I could look up to her. And as I grew, I eventually became her teammate, and still things never changed. Like, we were always just friends. And I loved watching her compete and perform. And then she retired, and we're still friends. And I have a lot of respect for her and for her, just the way she is as a person, her charisma, and the way that she always made me feel like I was a person and that I was seen. And yeah, she's one of my best friends now. So,
well, it's like Akeem saying, it's how people are, right? And that's what's amazing. It's not a medal that makes somebody better than another. It's how they include others and how they treat others. So, you know, you both get your start here in Calgary, really, the introduction to sport. And when you talk about inspiring, I literally think of people who are running the sport organizations and who are, you know, wanting people to have this experience of not just getting to the very top and getting to the Olympics or to the Paralympics, but it's about the fact of, you know, having those experiences that are life-changing. I want to ask you a quick question. Akeem and I were talking earlier. So I was on, I was being interviewed by Akeem on his podcast, and we talked about my role as chef in Beijing. And I had said that my dream was to be chef, and so I wouldn't get the Olympic rings tattoo until I was chef. That was just my deal with myself. So in December, 60 days before the games, I got my tattoo, but now I'm turning it over to you guys, because everybody assumed on my daughter's ringette team, everybody said, well, I'm assuming your mom has Olympic rings tattoo, and I didn't at that time. So Akeem, have you gotten one?
I have not. I'm mulling it over. There's just something about, you know, this thing that goes like this touching me. I just haven't gotten that over the hump yet.
Which makes me think of Abby's beekeeping. Tattoo rings, maybe?
Not yet. I've been pondering. I know, like, I want one eventually, but I think I'm a perfectionist, and I'm like, I have to make sure that it's exactly how I want it to be before I put it on my body permanently. Yeah. So, but I think maybe I'll make a goal like you and be like, hey, when I get when I do a certain
when
next
when you get
step,
really
then,
old?
Okay. No. Yes.
Yeah, you know what? It was it was just my own thing because they were my 11th games, 4 as athlete, 5 as media, 2 as mission team, but it was just something that sort of it was my goal, but it does not hurt. Well, it depends where. I have mine on my forearm, it does not hurt.
Forehead.
Yeah,
that
forehead.
That
yeah. You know, just as we wrap up, I want to thank both of you for what you've done for sport. You know, you've shown local athletes and you've shown all of us that you can start in a sport that maybe people don't think. Okay, perfect. We have a couple more minutes. Okay, good. Then, okay. I'm going to ask, another question. Because just before then, I thank you and I talk really about what you guys honestly have done for the youth and for all of us. What's next? Because, you know, Akeem, you're retired from competitive sport, but what's next for Akeem Haynes?
Yeah, you know.
And maybe even talking a little bit about what you do right now with the mentoring podcast.
Yeah, so, you know, I've been speaking while I was running, you know, so many people probably thought I just came out the work speaking. I have been speaking since I was 20, right? So when I wasn't in sport, you know, I was at my local schools, in the detention facility centers, wherever that I could, because sometimes people don't think their story is significant, but your story may be the one that inspires someone else. And so for me, I think it's a little bit selfish when we hold back those tough moments and we hold back our stories because we don't know who we could help, right? Inspiration, I never try to motivate people. Motivates like an energy drink, right? Like you drink it and you're pumped up, you know, you hit like 70 push-ups, you're like, yeah, but then it goes away. But when someone feels inspired, it carries them through. And so when I wasn't running, I was speaking. And so when I stepped away from it, I started doing it full time, you know, so obviously I had to learn the business aspect of it. But, you know, I had this crazy dream one day since I was like 19, 20 years old. I was like, man, there is a presence and an essence and a spirit about every person, right? And I remember, like, you could probably think of a name that comes to mind, like Martin Luther King comes to mind. And you could probably think of, you could probably picture him right here or something that he says. And I said, man, how can I make my presence and my essence something like that, right? Because we all know two types of people, right? There's someone that we come and we're just like, oh man, not this person again. Right. And you pick out your phone, you're trying to like, you just don't want to, they got a lot going on. They stress me out. But then you know someone else who you're just like, man, I'm so glad that our paths crossed. I'm so glad that I saw you today. And I've always said, how can I be like that person? Sport had nothing to do with it. It helps, but I want to be like that person. So that's why I speak, you know, that's why I do the podcast. And, you know, I had 4 speaking engagements last month, right? After doing virtual for so long, it's good to be in person. And I was probably too excited, right? But when you have a group of people in a room who is different walks of life, but they want to do one thing, and that's make the world better than they found it. I mean, isn't that what purposeful living is like? So that's why I speak. That's what I'll continue to speak. The podcast is just a tree of that for other things. So I got 2 books coming out, 2 new ones coming out as well too. Getting married in September. So there's a lot of things happening, but at the end of the day, my plan in life is to, if I can make the world better for those coming behind me in some capacity by being authentic to myself, because I'm never going to be something I'm not, then that's what living is about, and that's what I'll continue to do.
Wow, that's pretty amazing. We're fortunate to have your journey and to have you a part of you know, our community of sport, but just our community as well. So, thank you for that, Abby. What's next? I mean, I know tomorrow is fun, but to talk a little bit about what the near future and then what's next and continuing for 4 more.
Abby's got like 4 more medals in her.
Yeah. I keep saying, well, I got one color, so now I got to go back and get a few more. Definitely the next Olympics are in sight for me, and maybe the ones after that if Canada ends up having a bid, but it's hard to predict 8 years in the future. We'll see how the next tomorrow goes. But yeah, I mean, continuing to compete. I'm also in school right now. But I think what I want to bring from this medal and from our experience in Beijing and from, you know, all the experience I've had in the sport, I want to bring like our sport back to life in Calgary and in Canada. I think that I want that to be part of my legacy as an athlete and as a person. So I think I'm going to continue to try to learn to speak better like Akeem, or learn to articulate, you know, how I feel. And I like talking and I like sharing my story. And I think that there's a lot that can be learned from everyone's experiences. And yeah, I want to share my story and share what I've been through. And hopefully that brings light to my sport and to, yeah, sport in general.
Well, you speak really well. Yeah. So, you know, I think you are already in your young years an inspiration, because you've chosen a sport where, as you said, it's not always common. You know, and as a young female athlete, you're able to inspire other young female athletes. And, you know, it's not something that's always talked about, but Beijing, the Olympic team, was most gender equal Winter Games team that Canada had ever sent. 106 women, 109 men. So that's a huge celebration. And to know that you're, you know, a part of that, that's pretty special. So I know that lunch has arrived. Ethnicity Catering is going to feed us, which is wonderful. Yeah, I want to say thank you to Abby and to Akeem for what you've done for our community, for what you've done for the province, what you've done for the country, and what you've done for sport. Because, you know, you've both talked about wanting to make an impact and inspiring, and nobody has the same journey. Nobody has the same journey. And yet, you know, we all believe in sport and starting at that grassroots, which you both did. And we don't know the struggles that people are encountering, you know, whether they're physical, emotional, whatever it might be. You know, a lot of the people here and watching online are dealing with young athletes who are not sure if they can do something. So, you know, both of your example shows, gives inspiration to all of us that we want to continue to build, not just athletes who are going to get to the podium, but athletes who are great leaders in our community. So,
yeah. Can I say something?
Yes, of course.
No, you're absolutely right. I just wanted to say thank you to every person here. I know, and you and I spoke with this on the podcast a little bit. You don't always hear certain things enough. And from me, I know I don't want to speak for Abby, but I'm going to hopefully do her justice. Like, every position matters, and the work that you guys do, you don't get the appreciation for it. And you don't always get the kid who you invest in that comes back and they say, hey, thank you, or this and that. But sometimes the biggest gift that you can give to someone is helping them without thinking that they're going to get something back from it. It's nice. It's good to hear. But when you do something to help someone, it means your heart is in the right place. And to each of you, big thank you and much respect for you for continuing to show up for these kids and the youth in many different categories, because you're doing that and trying to balance your own life and everything that comes with it. So for me, to Abby, thank all of you, because look, the moment you tell me I got to do all this reading and administrative work, I'm just like, oh man, no, I'm okay. Right. So it's not an easy thing to do, but just know, just because you may not hear it, that it is truly, truly appreciated. And it's needed. It's needed.
Thank you for saying that, because it's true. I mean, most, you know, so many of our members who run sport organizations are volunteers. Our board, our committee, their passion and commitment to advancing sport and introducing sport. We know that not everybody's going to get to the level they dream of, but you two are examples that it can happen. So on behalf of all sport in our community, we want to thank both of you for taking part today, for doing what you're doing and continuing what you're doing and being a great example to not just to our youth, but to all of us, to the non so young as well. So thank you so much, you guys. Appreciate it. Okay, so we're wrapping up. Thank you, everybody, for participating. Those online, thank you for being a part of this. We know that we're still in the hybrid world, and we probably will be for a long time. You know, we've all overcome a lot, so let's continue to support each other, support sport. Yes, they both have their medals, so I'm sure you can feel free to take a look at them. And enjoy lunch. Thank you for being here, and we look forward to an action-packed 2022 full of different sport events. So thanks, everybody.